all that were here did an amazing job. I was only here for a short period of time. Some of you were here for many, many hours, and the flea market was a huge success. So thank you to the deacons and everybody else who put in countless hours and time for that wonderful activity. It's always good to see the community just using our space and being around here. So thank you all for that, and even for folks who came out and shopped. Thanks for being here. It's a big endeavor, and we couldn't have done it without everybody helping. So can we give them a round of applause, do you think? I literally did it in a round. Did you see that? You can tell I used to do kids' men. I can't do a round of applause without a circle. Okay, well, I'm glad you're all here today. I do have a couple of announcements. The first is when last I was in the parlor, there were still some goodies left over from Sunday. So if you are, by Sunday, I mean yesterday. Some people call it Saturday, which is the real name for it. So there are still some goodies left over from the bake sale. You can take a bag. There's a basket for a free will offering, and you can fill that up with any of those leftover goodies that I promise are delicious, but I don't think gluten-free. So feel free to take them all because I can't eat them for you. Also, our fellowship time today is going to be in the parlor, which will give you an extra chance to peruse those goodies. So don't head outside, because there's often on rain. We'll head over to the parlor for fellowship today. I think those are all my today-specific announcements, but I do want to remind you that Thursday the 27th, so a couple Thursdays from now, we're going to have a healing service right here in the sanctuary. It's at 7 p.m., and it's just going to be an opportunity to hopefully have some peaceful time connecting with God and bringing about some healing in our lives. So there's information about it in the bulletin, on the website, and the Facebook page, and I do hope you'll consider coming to that service. And then one thing I do have about our service today, we're doing something different. Our prayer of illumination, prayer for illumination, is a sung prayer. So we're all going to, it's right after the children's moment. You'll know it's starting because Corrine will play music. That's a good hint that we're going to sing. You can stay seated if you'd like, but we're going to sing the prayer for illumination together. It's thy word, and I'm pretty sure you might be familiar with it. Are there any other announcements we need to share this morning? All right, I don't see any, so let me open us with a word of prayer. Gracious God, I thank you for each and every member of this community. I thank you for the folks that are present with us today, the folks that are joining us virtually from wherever they might be, the folks that will watch this back at another time, and the folks who, for whatever reason, aren't able to worship with us today. Thank you that each and every one of them make up this big family of yours, Lord. I ask that you use this time. You open up our hearts and our souls and our minds and pour your goodness into us so that we can continue to do your work in this world. In your name we pray, everybody says, amen. All right.
Good morning. I invite you to stand and join with me in the call to worship. We gather together to remember. We gather together to offer praise.
We come together to live across truth, to hold fast to God's laws, and to rejoice in God's word.
Thank you.
to follow God's word, but often gather as unruly children with petty fights and concerns distracting us. Let us now pause, confess our sin, and allow God to draw us together so that we might set our minds on the Lord alone. Please join me in the unison prayer of confession. Lord our God, we confess that we do not reflect your glory. We have not prepared our hearts to receive the gift of your word. We allow thorns and weeds to grow in the places where you plant the gospel. Forgive us, restore and reorder our lives by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Accomplish all that you desire in us so that we may bear good fruit to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Scripture teaches us that there is no condemnation in Jesus Christ. Wherever we have been and wherever we are headed, we are not far from God's grace given through Jesus Christ. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Thanks be to God. May the peace of Christ be with you. Please share the peace with your neighbor.
And we've got a good crowd coming down. Hi, guys. Come on. I'll sit on my stool today. But I'm going to show some pictures, so at one point I'll hold them up. Okay. Your dresses are lovely, ladies. I like how they match. It's very sisterly. Okay. How are ya? Hi, I'm Emily. Hi, I like your piggy tails. Do you think I should wear piggy tails like that next week? Yeah? Okay, maybe, we'll see. All right. So today, with the grown-ups, I'm gonna read a story about a sower, so a gardener. They call it the sower, but he sows seeds, not like sows with a needle and thread. And in the story, you'll hear, if you're listening, that he throws, I gotta shift this way. You're all very much this way. I didn't do my leg workout to do my squats this way. Okay, so in the story, he throws these seeds everywhere. And some of them grow really well. And some of them don't grow so well. Or some grow and then they get gobbled up by birds. So I'm going to show you some pictures, and I want you to tell me what you notice about these plants. And they're not very big, so sorry about that. So here's two on this one, and I'm going to scroll. Here's a close-up on the tree roots. Do you see where they're growing? And then, look, there's a bunch of moss. The grown-ups have no idea what you're looking at. It could be something totally different. Well, they might be able to see over here, but that's it. That's it. Nobody has no idea. So there's a bunch of, here, I'll show. There's a bunch of moss growing out of like a gas tank and a bunch of plants growing out of a crack in the sidewalk here. And then over here, this is like a tree that grew, nobody can see it there. This is like a tree that grew around a statue, and it looks like the statue got eaten by the tree, right? And then there's below it, there's flowers growing out of the sidewalk. This one's a bunch of tree roots growing through a wall, but the wall's still standing. I don't really know how it works, actually. These are plants. This is a dandelion, which are very hard to get rid of if anybody's tried. Growing up, that's not, it scrolled. This is a dandelion. Growing up through a road. See how it made like a bump in the road and grew through it? And then these are ferns growing through a tree. I'm skipping to my favorite. Then there's this log coming out of water. Did you see like a tree starting to grow from the log coming out of the water? Do you think that these are ideal circumstances for where to plant a seed? But they're all growing there. Here's a tomato growing inside of like the center of a gate. I don't think you're going to be able to harvest that tomato. You'd have to like make ketchup on the spot with it, right? Ooh, here's another tree in a sidewalk. It looks like a bonsai tree. Like somebody's been tending it. I don't think they have. So how do these things happen? Is that like ideal growing conditions? How many of you guys have ever planted something? Have you ever planted something? Any seeds ever in your life? And did you plant it in the middle of your driveway? No. Did you plant it inside the car? You planted a seed in my car. That is important information I will come back to later. Did you plant it in a statue? No, that's a silly place, right? Did you plant it in the garden?
Yeah.
Or like in a pot?
Yeah.
You grew it in a pot. That seems like a logical place to grow a plant. Would it be silly to plant seeds in your mailbox? And then when the mail person came, the mail carrier came, there'd just be flowers waiting for them, right? But where would they put your mail? Also, what did you know when you planted your seed? Did you have to make sure that it got water?
Yes.
And what else did it need? Do you remember? Sunlight, right? And some people... Okay. Oh, you just grew it the other day? Is it growing yet?
Yeah.
Do you know what kind of plant it's going to be? A blue plant. That's very exciting. Blue plants are popular. So, but normally when we plant things, we tend to them and we care for them, right? We don't just throw it anywhere and hope it works out. But all these things grew in crazy spots. Why do you think that happens? Ooh, that's a good idea. Maybe a bird picked up a seed and dropped it. Those dandelions, have you guys ever picked a dandelion and made a wish and blown it? Which is so fun when you're a kid, but then when you're a grown up and you see people doing that, you're like, oh, my lawn's gonna be covered in dandelions, because we get real cranky as grown ups about things like that. But as a kid, it's nothing's more fun. Or to catch them, and then if you catch it and it doesn't get crushed, you make a wish and blow it away. Does that still happen? Do you guys still do that? When I was little, we used to do that. So it could just have fallen there. But how does it grow? When you work so hard to grow a plant for your mom for Mother's Day, or you plant a vegetable garden on your pool deck and you work all the time to keep it nice and chipmunks still eat all your strawberries, I'm just saying that might happen to somebody. How come it's so hard to grow those things, but these things grew in these crazy places? But where are they getting nutrients from? There's rain and sunlight, but they're not in the soil. They're in strange places. Do you think sometimes God can make things happen in really unusual spots?
Yep.
Yep. I think Robbie's ready to be done with this chat. Do you think so? So that's one of the things we're going to talk about with the grown-ups, that even though in the story we talk about four different types of soil, don't worry, we're not going through them all. We are rounding the bend to the end here. We talk about how there's like good soil and then these three other soils that aren't considered good soil. But we just saw all these things that grew in what we would not call good soil, right? So, some were no soil, like a gas tank for sure does not have soil in it. I don't know how the moss got there. I don't know. But it still grew. So even when things are kind of yucky or not fun or not good, God is still there and can still make really beautiful things happen, like a cool tree grow on a branch in the middle of a lake. Make a little bit of sense? All right. Oh, did any of you want to say the prayer?
Nope.
Robbie is real excited to not pray. Anybody want to pray? No? Okay, how about I say it this time? So here, you guys are newer, so we do a big clap. So stretch your arms really big. Try not to hit one another. I'm very nervous about you, your clap there. All right, ready? And we're on 1, 2, 3, we're going to clap, and I'm going to pray while our hands are tingling from our big clap, okay? 1, 2, 3. Lord, I thank you that you can make things beautiful no matter where we are or what the situation. Help us to find your beauty each and every day. Everybody said, amen. Are your hands still tingling?
Yes.
You got to keep praying if they're still tingling. No, you can keep praying while you walk back to where you were sitting, though. How about that? Thanks, guys. Hey, thanks for joining me.
Our first reading comes from Psalm 119, verses 105 to 112. Listen now to the word of God. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it to observe your righteous ordinances. I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your ordinances. I hold my life in my hand continually, but I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, but I do not stray from your precepts. Your decrees are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. I incline my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. The word of the Lord.
So this week, we are continuing to explore community building. And the first week, if you were with us, we looked at what it means to be welcoming folks, not as we desire to be welcomed, but in a way that receives whomever we're welcoming as God's beloved. And then last week, we looked at what it means to work together, learning about God from others, taking Jesus' yoke upon us by working together to accomplish all that God has for us and easing the weight of living our lives. This week, I sort of gave it away. We're going to look at Matthew 13, verses 1 through 9, and then 18 through 23. Listen for God's word for us today. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, A sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them. Other seeds fell on the rocky ground, where they didn't have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, but since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Anyone with ears, listen. And now jumping to verse 18. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on the rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was grown on the good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, this passage is sometimes called the parable of the four soils. If you look at the text, there's four types of soil listed: the pathway, the rocky ground, the thorny soil, and the good soil. The pathway is where people walk regularly, and the seeds that fell there were just gobbled up by birds. Jesus later equates this pathway to the people who hear about God but don't understand. Perhaps they've questions that they don't get answered. The rocky ground is just that, it's rocky. There isn't much soil there, and the seeds sprout quickly, but they don't have roots, so they don't last. When the sun comes out, like it was yesterday, very bright and hot, they just end up scorched and dry out. Jesus compares folks who hear God's word quickly and receive it with joy, but don't develop roots. That's the comparison there. When they face trouble, they don't know how to handle their faith, and therefore they often turn away. The third type of soil is the thorns. The seeds took root, and they started to grow, but those thorns, they overtook them, and, well, the plants didn't make it. Thorny folks are people who hear God's word and perhaps even believe it and live faithfully for a bit, but the lure of the world overtakes them. And then the final type of soil is the good soil. The good soil brings forth the rewards, the grain. Jesus compares the good soil to folks who hear God's word, understand God's word, and then bear fruit. Now, reading through this list, we obviously want to be good soil, right? But the more I think about it and read through it, I wonder if perhaps we have seasons in each type of soil. Because I can distinctly think of times when my faith could have been described as any of these categories. Do you remember last week we talked about learning from the infants, the folks in other types of soil, the ones that we wouldn't categorize as the good soil? They actually might be able to be described as those infants, don't you think? They're people who have things to offer us. We can learn from them and their experiences. We can grow our faith by exploring the questions of those on the pathway at risk of the birds eating them up. We can listen for what's challenging to them, because that very thing might actually challenge us and then result in our own faith being deepened. The folks that are experiencing the excitement from early growth in that rocky ground, well, that excitement could be contagious. It can offer us new perspectives and enliven our faith. I am often revived by folks who have stories of ministry success. The folks that have recently had mountaintop experiences. When I was growing up, we would say that they were on fire for God. Do you guys remember we used to say that a lot? I don't know because we didn't know each other. But that was a phrase that was used regularly, right? Wow, they're really on fire for God. Which, now that I reflect on it, is actually a really good metaphor for this type of soil. Because think about it. When you light a match, we have some. I could demonstrate, but I'll burn myself, so I'm not gonna. When you light a match, it burns fast and brightly, right? But once the match gets to the end of the matchstick, the fire goes out. It's done. Folks on that path, on that rocky path, while that level of passion and excitement might be fleeting, their energy in that moment is powerful. And just like a match can be used to light other things on fire and spread that excitement and fire, so can people in that moment on the rocky path, when they are on fire for God, they might help contagious in a good way, not in a COVID contagious way, that's scary, in a good way, sharing that excitement for God. Now, folks on the thorny soil can share their worldly perspective with us, and they can offer us a point of view that we might never know because we don't know the things that they know. We're not exposed to the world that they're exposed to. They could open our eyes to life situations we've never considered. They could shepherd in new innovations that may just grow and change our ministries. I know that sounds crazy because the church is known for being on the cutting edge of innovation just across the world and board, but sometimes we actually learn and grow from other areas. And if we don't expose ourselves to folks in different worlds with different perspectives, maybe the secular world, they help us to see. If we don't reach out to them, we're going to miss out on a world of opportunity. You can see there's value in each and every type of soil, and each and every type can be part of our community. In fact, I strongly believe that we do indeed need each type in our community to have a robust faith community. Now, in the past, when reading this passage, I've stopped at this point. I've stopped at the good soil, thinking about the soil types and where I want to be. I've focused on how I become a person planted in good soil and how to accomplish that goal. And honestly, I haven't even really thought about the value of the other type of soils, as we just did. But when I was preparing for the sermon, this time reading through it, I noticed something I'd overlooked probably 40 or 50 times before. The sower, the gardener, the person planting the seeds. Where do they plant the seeds? Everywhere. Everywhere. The sower tosses the seeds without a care, in my mind, when I'm envisioning it. They're just like, everyone gets a seed, you know? I guess it would be everywhere gets a seed, not everyone. But they just toss the seeds everywhere. Now, I really like to grow a garden. I'm still working on my garden at our current house. We've only been there for not quite 3 years. And it takes time to get your garden situated, especially if it was maintained differently for whomever lived there before you. Now, our old house, it took me almost the entire 8 years we lived there to pull every single one of those annoying spiky thistle things that have the nice, pretty purple flowers, but also will stab you even through the thickest of gardening gloves. You know it. And then it sticks in your finger and you can't get it out for at least a week and it hurts every time you do anything else. It took 8 years to get rid of those thistles. The new owners live a thistle-free home. Even the raised beds I plant on the pool deck, which may or may not have strawberry plants in them, there are plants, but no berries. Even those raised beds, they require a lot of work. I make sure that I don't see a single cucumber beetle or squash bug. And when I see even one, I treat the plant, I treat the soil, I get real angry about it and stomp around the house and complain about the bugs. I don't think that gets rid of them, but it makes me feel better about it. I make sure they get the right amount of water. I feed the plants with Miracle-Gro, specially formulated for that type of plant. The hydrangeas get the high acid Miracle-Gro because hydrangeas like that. It's a lot of, I take better care of these plants than I do myself. I just eat whatever food's gluten-free. But these plants, they get nothing but the best. You would think I have blooming, beautiful gardens. I don't have a single zucchini. Not one. I have lots of zucchini flowers, but not one zucchini yet. The cucumbers are looking good. And I'm not sure about the watermelon crop this year. It's not looking great. I do all these things to ensure that these gardens are going to be the best possible. And I'm telling you, I don't think I'm going to get a zucchini. The sower, though, the gardener, he just tosses these seeds everywhere and anywhere. And I never stop to think about why. If we know, if Jesus took time to explain all the different types of soil and the things that happen from the different types of soil, why would the sower plant everywhere? Why wouldn't the sower do, like, rake the garden first before he planted the seeds like I do? The gardener plants everywhere because God can create anywhere, in any circumstances. I just went on and on about how hard I work to create and maintain my gardens, which are not beautiful. It's hard work. But then we see these big, bountiful plants growing in the most unusual of places, like I showed the kiddos. My sister, she has this pumpkin crop growing in her yard from seeds that came from a rotten pumpkin last year that they threw out for the deer to eat. She could have a pumpkin patch this year. Pay off her mortgage with all that pumpkin sales. I don't know how much pumpkins go for. Apparently, I think it's very expensive. She's not out there looking for squash bugs. Oh, or that I got this fungus on my pumpkins last year. She's not worrying about that. She's just going to get them. Plants grow well in terrible environments all the time. I bet if we pause, we can all think of a plant we've seen growing in a weird spot. I have a tree growing in my driveway. We pull it out every year, and somehow it comes back between the two concrete slabs. And I pull it out, and then it comes back. It really is determined to live there. It happens all the time. This parable, it's a parable. It's a story used to teach a lesson. But people aren't seeds. Even more so than seeds, we have the ability to change our environment or our soil situation. We can connect with others and learn from them, grow with them. Which, if you think, after we welcomed them the first week, last week, we talked about the importance of learning from others, growing with them. So then when we learn and grow from them, then God can create beautiful, bountiful plants in the strangest of circumstances. And if God can do that, imagine what he can do with us. Imagine how God might use folks in so many varied situations to do holy work, to teach and to guide one another, to remind us that no matter what our soil type that we're in right now, he is sowing seeds in our lives, in our periphery. And with God's help, we can take root, real root, wherever it might be. In God's eyes, every single one of us, each of us, each of God's seeds counts, matters, and every single one of us is able to thrive with God's love God's nurture and grace. No matter where we're planted, what our circumstances, what soil we've been in, that maybe we got dug up and transplanted in new soil, we can all thrive. Because every single one counts. And we can nurture and grow and cross-pollinate with one another to create a beautiful, bountiful garden full of God's precious seeds blossoming into flowers. Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, you meet us where we are. You remind us that while perhaps we haven't picked the path that we are planted on, the soil type that we might be residing in, you can move mountains, you can move hearts and minds. Help us to glean the lessons we can learn from folks, no matter where they are, who they are, what their soil condition might be, so that together we can all become the good soil, doing your work in the world. In your name we pray, amen.
Thank you.
say together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. I invite you now to share your tithes and offerings in the offertory plates that are in the back of the sanctuary, or please consider to give a donation online. Thank you.
Sometimes his eyes were gentle and filled with laughter, and sometimes they cried. Sometimes there was a fire of holy anger in Jesus' eyes. But the eyes that saw hope in the hopeless, that saw through the fault to the need, are the same eyes that look down from heaven into the deepest part of you and me. His eyes are always upon us. His eyes never close in sleep, and no matter where you go, you will always be in his eyes, in his eyes. Sometimes his voice comes calling like rolling thunder or like driving rain. Sometimes his voice is quiet and we start to wonder if he knows our pain. But he who spoke peace to the water cares more for our hearts than the waves. And he who once said, "You're forgiven," still says, "You're forgiven today, today." Sometimes I look above me when stars are shining, and I feel so small. How could the God of heaven and all creation know I'm here at all? But then in the silence he whispers, "My child, I created you too, and you're my most precious creation. I even gave my son for you." And his eyes, they're always upon us. His eyes, they never close in sleep. And no matter where you go, you will always be in his eyes. No matter where you go, you will always be in his eyes. his eyes. Sometimes his eyes were gentle and filled with laughter.
Lord, you have given us life, and therefore we strive to live our lives in gratitude. You have given us salvation, and therefore we strive to live in peace. You have given us abundance, and therefore we offer these gifts in gratitude. Let us live our lives centered on all you do, and bless us as agents of your will and way. Amen.
It is now the time of the service where we share our joys and concerns, and I'm going to start with a prayer request today. This coming Wednesday, I will be presiding over at a service, a graveside service for a lovely woman named Helen Beams. We don't know Helen. She's from Ohio, but she has a connection to Pittsburgh, and so I have the honor of getting to do her memorial, her funeral. It's a graveside service this coming Wednesday. So prayers for Helen's family and loved ones who are coming from all over to lay her to rest on Wednesday. Just keep them in your thoughts and prayers if you don't mind, because they don't have a lot of connections here anymore. So if they know there's folks praying for them, I think that'll help them out. Helen's husband was a Presbyterian minister and he went to Pittsburgh Theological Seminary, and he and Helen met at New Wilmington Missionary Conference, so there's tons of connections here that they were very excited to hear about and know that we would be holding them in prayer in this time. What other prayer requests, joys, and concerns? Yes, sir.
My wife's name is Mary Ann.
Oh, my goodness. 30 years. Happy anniversary. What else do we have? Karen, I see you. Oh.
Where's our neighbor, Gary Krebs? He's having continued health problems. He had treatment for cancer that spread last year, and all went well, and now things have gone south for him. So he and his wife, Laura, need a lot of prayers.
Prayers for Gary and his wife, absolutely. Did I see another one there? You brought seeds today. Well, look at you sowing seeds. Literal and figurative seed sowing happening here today. Prayers for God. Prayers of thanksgiving that God is always at work, huh? Dawn, I see you up there. The surgery, yeah. All right. We've got them. Tina Marie, Beverly, Denise, and the other two folks we were praying for last week, there's a surgery happening. I believe it's tomorrow. Yep, the 17th, if I'm remembering correctly. So prayers for all of those folks. Yes, ma'am, Deb. Absolutely. That is a tough time, and I know a couple of folks in our community are experiencing that right now. Yes, Bruce.
Yeah, prayers for our friend Jim. That's another treatment tomorrow.
Starting another round. Which round is this one?
Six.
So is this the halfway mark?
Don't know yet.
Okay, hopefully the halfway mark. We're praying that it's going well. Jim starts treatment next round of treatment starts tomorrow. So prayers for Jim as he undergoes his next round. What, Laura, yes, thank you.
I have a joy. My friend Susan is home from the hospital. We prayed for her for the last couple.
Yeah. Susan's home. That's great news. What else, ma'am?
I'm having MRIs tomorrow.
Tomorrow is your MRI. Prayers for Laura's MRI tomorrow, that it is the information the doctors need and good news. All right. Miss April, did you have one that you told me about? What's the last name?
Pardini.
Pardini?
Yeah, it's in the news, so.
Okay, so April had a client who underwent surgery. They're doing well, so praises that it's going well and prayers for continued healing. And then another client's cousin was brutally attacked. And last update is that they were in a medically induced coma, but they're showing positive signs. So prayers for the Pardini family as that situation continues, absolutely. Continue prayers for Carrie. We're gonna continue to pray for Bob's daughter, Carrie. What else do we have? Anything else? All right, if there is and I missed it, I am certain God knows. So let me pray for us all. Lord, I thank you that you are with us, that you hear us and know our prayers. We pray, Lord, for Helen's family as they travel in for her graveside service this coming Wednesday. And we thank you that they can be comforted knowing that there is a big cloud of witnesses, your whole community, Lord, praying for them. We thank you, Lord, for the joy of 30 years together, the excitement and the connections you provide for us. We pray, Lord, for Gary and his health issues, for Tina Marie, Beverly, Denise, and those other folks we were praying for last week. We pray, Lord, for Melissa, that things go smoothly and quickly and that she find her next spot as soon as possible, and Lord, that it's the right spot for her. Lord, we pray for Jim's treatment starting again tomorrow. We ask, Lord, that you strengthen his body, that this treatment do exactly what it's intended to do and bring him back to health. We thank you, Lord, that Susan is home, and we pray for Laura's MRI tomorrow, that it reveal what needs to be revealed and that it be easy and something that is manageable, or nothing at all. Lord, we pray for April's client. We thank you that surgery went well and they are recovering, and pray that they continue to do so. And we pray for the Pardini family as they work through some very challenging and hard situations. We continue to pray for Carrie, Lord, and ask that you guide her to her next spot as well. Lord, we ask all of these things and the things we haven't spoken out loud, but have whispered in our hearts, and maybe even haven't dared to whisper in our hearts, knowing that you are with us at all times. Hear these prayers and us as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now to the one who is able to keep you from falling and to make you stand without shame in the presence of God's glory with rejoicing. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be the glory, the majesty, the power, and authority before all time, now and forever. Be watchful, stand firm in your faith, be courageous and strong, and let all that you do be done in love. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace.